بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This our case today. This is 4 days old, preterm, 28 weeks. Very low birth weight, 1.25 kg. Admitted in the first day due to RDS and received 1 dose of surfactant. Then extubated and bottled in nasal bubble sebum. Peep 5 cm water and FI oxygen now is 25%. Second day, we started trophic feed, 1 ml Q4 hourly, and the baby was tolerated and no concern about it. The third day, we, by clinical assessment, the baby was having machinery murmur, pounding pulse, and hyperdynamic circulation, so we request echo to rule out BDA. Echo done, there is large significant BDA for which we started paracetamol injections, 10 milligram per kg for 3 days, and the echo follow up after 3 days. This day four, actually our nursing staff, sister IV, reported to us now the baby has?
The baby developed abdominal distension, increase in abdominal girth for 1.5 centimeters. And now the baby was noted to have a gastric aspirate of green secretions. Doctor, can you show how? For about 3 to 4 ml.
This is a greenish aspirate, almost more than.
And the baby has also difficulty passing bowel for more than 24 hours. And referred to pedosurgery for possible intestinal obstruction.
So after we take history from our nursing staff, you have to assess the patient clinically and biochemically and radiologically. So we assess this baby clinically. So we thought about this maybe feeding intolerance or intestinal obstruction or neck or paralytic ileus. So clinical assessment. This abdominal, there is mild abdominal distension, and there is UVC, and actually the it was the bowel is loopy before, but now it's a little bit it's improved, and also we cannot there is we did the auscultations, and it was actually sluggish. We did here actually we check it. The abdomen, sluggish abdominal sound. So based on the history and this bowel also, the bowel actually is passing the meconium here. It's okay. It's okay. So and there is greenish aspirate. There is greenish aspirate. Based on the history, we took it from our nursing staff. Abdominal distension and the greenish aspirate and the passing bowel. And the GI assessment, there is mild abdominal distension, but the bowel is soft, no tenderness. And also, he passed now, the bowel is open. Systemic examinations, the capillary fill time actually is 2 seconds, and saturated wheel, vital sign is stable, and no systemic mistation, apnea, bradycardia, or circulatory insufficient, or desaturations. So our impression, so we take history, by clinical assessment, GI and extra GI. So our ambition is feeding intolerance, septic ileus, paralytic ileus, or necrotizing enterocolitis. Since there is greenish aspirate, this is surgical abdomen until proved otherwise. Especially if the full-term babies will be bulbous or malrotation. In premature babies, we think about necrotizing enterocolitis, or we'll have to look for the rheumatoid intestinalis in the radiological finding. So this is the clinical assessment. So we request for this patient's actually lab work. This is our lab work. We request for him this blood gas. It showed the pH 7.27 and BSO2 40s, and the lactate 2.1 and bicarb is 18 and basic cis minus 8. This is picture of metabolic acidosis. So and also we request for this patient actually the electrolytes and biochemical assessment. The sodium is 147 also, and also we request for him the CBC and FBC. The platelets is 300. So this is history. She gave us this is abdominal distension, greenish aspirate, and bowel is not open. This is the history. Clinical assessment, the bowel actually is soft and relaxed, but mild, distended, and the baby was passing stool, and there is greenish aspirate. This is the GI. Extra GI systemic examination, being hemodynamically stable, vitally stable. So, based on the history and the clinical examination, our impression feeding intolerance, paretic ileus, septic ileus, or necrotizing tuberculitis, and the lab work, we have to see for HAT. HAT, hyponatremia, no hyponatremia, and also you have to look for metabolic acidosis, and you have to look for there is any platelets low or thrombocytopenia. We finished now the history, clinical assessment, and biochemical assessment. We'll go for radiological assessment. This is the radiological assessment, actually. You can go there, Peter. It will be easy for us. This is the abdominal X-ray. I have to comment about it. You can consider for the X-ray. You have to look for, this is AB and the lateral. We did lateral decubitus. The AB, we are looking for either to take from up, middle, and down. Up, we have to comment about the diaphragm. There is any free air in the diaphragm to rule out pneumoperitoneum, or thick diaphragm. How to know this is thick diaphragm? By hypertranslucent. But actually, is no hypertranslucent, so I cannot appreciate any free air or pneumoperitoneum. The second items, and also I cannot appreciate any portal gases here. So the second item I have to comment about the bowel. Bowel 3P. B-BOC, bowel edema, there is no bowel edema, or bowel thickness, or bowel gas, abnormal bowel gas. It's normal distribution of bowel gas. And the other three, B, they call it P-PIN, pneumatosis intestinalis, I cannot appreciate intramural gases, and portal gas, I cannot appreciate portal gas, or pneumoproteinium, or there is any perforation. I have to comment about also the rectum, there is rectal gas, indicate there is no intestinal obstruction, and also no free air. So this is the abdominal X-ray, and the lateral X-ray actually is no free air can be appreciated. This is how to interpret the abdominal X-ray with patient with surgical abdomen. Just to check the diaphragm, then the bowel, then check the rectum, and the bowel 3B, it's called bowel thickness, bowel edema, bowel gas distribution, or 3B, pneumatitis intestinalis, or portal gas, or pneumoperitoneum. This is the radiological. It's okay, we finish now the clinical assessment, history, clinical assessment, and we put the impression, this patient actually, this is feeding intolerance, paretic ileus, septic ileus, and suspected neck to rule out surgical abdomen or intestinal obstruction. Based on the history, clinical examination, and biochemical, actually only just metabolic acidosis, and the platelets was normal 300, and sodium 147 is no hyponatremia. Radiological actually is non-specific finding in the X-ray. I cannot appreciate any pneumatosis intestinalis or pneumoperitoneum. So based on the clinical sign and biochemical and radiological sign, this is called suspected neck, is based on the clinical and radiological, this is called suspected neck. So how to manage this patient? We consulted the pediatric surgery to assess the patient. Actually, he said this no specific clinical, no specific clinical sign or specific radiological sign. This is call it paralytic ileus or septic ileus, and our management, it will be conservative or medical or surgical, based on the severity of the disease, based on the stability of the patient, and based on the stages of this neck. So this, you call it stage one, this is suspected neck. Stage one, suspect, based on clinical clinical sign, symptom, and sign, and X-ray non-specific finding. Also, if stage two, we call it Bell's criteria or modified Bell's criteria, stage two, it will be, there is clinical sign, symptoms, and also it will be pneumatosis intestinalis. Stage two, A and P, it will depend on the clinical assessment of the patient. Mildly ill, it will be stage two A, and if mildly, if there is moderately ill, it will be stage 2B. The stage 3 is already advanced. The stage 2, it's called definitive or confirmed or proven. The stage 3 is called definitive. It will be also, there is clinical assessment, and also there is pneumatosis signals, and maybe it will be severely ill. But it will be stage 3A and B based on there is impending peritoneal perforations, or there is a pneumoperitoneum, or there is incisional perforation. It will be stage 3A, it will be impending peritoneal perforation. Stage 3B, it will be there is perforation. Bending, this means stagnant or fixed dilated bowels. It will indicate dead bowels, indicate gangrenous bowel. Based on this stage, we'll treat. So this our case is stage 1, suspected neck or paralytic eloseptic ileus, because non-specific finding and the clinic based on the clinical finding and the radiological finding. So we have to treat this patient in 5N. N, this we have to keep him in EPO to rest the gut, and the second NGT free drainage just to decompress the abdomen, ventilate the stomach. And no in normal saline, fluid resuscitation, and the TBN, and maybe on the TBN and the fluid resuscitations. And the fourth thing, you have to notify the surgeon. Actually, specifically, if there is any finding of pneumatosis and cyanosis, you have to notify him. If there is pneumoperitoneum or perforation, you have to call him immediately. Come, this is surgical emergency. And the fifth B, it will be non-specific radiological finding. You have to take septal cup and start it. Antibiotic. Antibiotic, it will be actually, there is a lot of controversy about these antibiotics. It will start from ampicillin based on your biograms, based if you have any ID consultant in your hospital. It will be empirical treatment, and then the culture will come, then we'll identify your antibiotic. Antibiotic regimen is actually 10 antibiotic, called supportive. 10 regimen for the antibiotics. There is in ampicillin Genta, ampicillin Amica, ampicillin Sifu. Actually, there is ampicillin Tazobactam, or some people Funko with Amikacin or Meropenem. There's a lot of regimen based on your biograms, based on if you have ID consultant who will direct your management, you can start it ampicillin on gentamicin. So the suspected neck, actually, the difference between 1 and 2 based on the duration of the antibiotic. In the stage 1, I have to continue for 48 to 72 hours. And the stage 2, I have to continue 10 to 14 days antibiotics. And the stage 3, I have to continue for 14 days. But stage 3, if there is perforation, you have to add to your regimen the clindamycin or metronidazole to cover the anaerobic, for anaerobic coverage. For sure, we have to counsel the parents for such cases and update them about the condition, and tell them why this patient liable for the neck, because there is risk factor. What is the risk factor for neck for this patient? Actually, this is 3P. It's premature, it's more liable for that. Premature formula, because it's not breastfeeding, this patient in the bottle feed, and ischemic gut. Ischemic gut, because this patient having BDA and no polycythemia, and no evidence of perinatal asphyxia, just the risk factor in this baby, the PDA and the umbilical catheter. It's also, this is risk, and we don't have perinatal asphyxia or polycythemia as risk, but we have the other risk, the prematurity and premature enteral feeding, bacterial growth. And the gut actually will be immature and non-functioning, and the motility, it will be, there is delayed or lacking in the motility of this such cases of the premature babies. So we have to counsel them regarding the risk factor and the prognosis, short or long-term outcome, and mortality and morbidity. At the end, I would like to thank our staff in the unit that's helping us for the administration of such cases. And also, I would like to pray for my colleagues going for exam, our board, so the board, Jordanian board, and our colleague in the United Fellowship, Asalar Branch Lavin, and Yaka Kulizumana, the Khlift Barat, women Ahia Afaka, and Nama Ahia Nasa Jinya. Shukran, salam alaikum. Thank you.